He says, "Greetings, gentlemen. I greet you here on the banks of the James River in the year of our Lord, 1712. First of all, I shall thank you, gentlemen of the colony of Virginia, for bringing me here. I am here to help you solve some of your problems with slaves. Your invitation reached me on my modest plantation in the West Indies, where I have experimented with some of the newest and still oldest methods for controlling slaves. Ancient Rome would envy us if my program was implemented. As our boat sailed on the James River, named for our illustrious king, whose version of the Bible we cherish, I saw enough to know that your problem is not unique. While Rome used cords of wood as crosses for standing human bodies along its highways, you are using the tree and the rope on occasion. I caught the whiff of a dead slave hanging from a tree a couple of miles back." This is what he says. "You are not only losing valuable stock by hangings, you are having uprising. Slaves are running away. Your crops are sometimes left in the field too long for maximum profit. You suffer occasional fires and your animals are killed. Gentlemen, you know what your problems are. I do not need to elaborate. I'm not here to enumerate your problems. I'm here to introduce to you a method of solving them." This is what he says. "I have a foolproof method for controlling your black slaves. I guarantee every one of you that if installed correctly, it will control the slaves for at least 300 years. For at least the activity that went on in the soil of Virginia. There was the battle for our freedom or for our emancipation, and for is that it is an epicenter for the production of slavery. To this day, my own experience, I have experienced African Americans' minds who do not go past menial living, wage earning, the lack of schooling, and if it is school, it has to be a religious culture. There is a religious teaching, but there's also a spiritual teaching. Two great people, Apostle Smallwood E. Williams and Bishop Alfred Keith. Apostle Smallwood E. Williams was the founder of what we now know today as the Biblewood Church. This man, in 84 years of his life, changes the paradigm of how life is lived as an African American. He's born in Lynchburg. Lynchburg is not progressive enough for the spirit that he has and the soil that he's born of. Sometimes you're born in a place that's not ready for what's been put in you by God, and so your spirit will move you out of a place that you've been born into, and until there is almost an earthquaking, there is a shifting. The environment is not always conducive for the destiny that's dwelling in you. And so Apostle Williams was a man that moved from Lynchburg up to Ohio with Bishop Lawson, and he became a preacher very early on in his life, just like I did. I preached somewhere around that same age. And he was commissioned by Bishop Lawson to leave Ohio and come to Washington, D.C. When Bishop Lawson commissioned Apostle Williams, at that time he was Elder Williams, to come to Washington, D.C., there was, of course, segregation going on in this city. We were still separated in this city. It was prior to Martin Luther King being great. It was prior to Malcolm X being great. When Apostle Williams was commissioned to this city, he was approximately 19 to 20 years old. He told Apostle Williams to come here. Bishop Lawson told him two things. He said, "Washington, D.C. is a preacher's graveyard and a missions wreck shop. If you wanna die, go to Washington. If you want to be destroyed, go to Washington." He brought a piece of property that the government tried to condemn. Instead of the government being able to condemn that piece of property, they had to, watch this, build a beltway around the man's church because he would not give up his property. He fought tooth and nail. He was one of the most progressive African Americans that were operative in that day. He marched with Martin Luther King. He dealt with Malcolm X. The reason why the man is so important to me is by the time he had died, he died in 1990. Williams had defied slavery. He had defied dysfunction. And he defied the things that we as a people have to suffer constantly under, African American people. What you have to understand in this hour, if you're a minister, if you're a preacher, if you're a servant, if you're a business owner, this is the principle. Jerusalem, Judea, othermost part of the earth. Love to use the scripture. Jerusalem means you have to be great to your people first. You have to pass the test of conquering the monster that opposes your prosperity on your own soil. Once you have conquered it on your own soil, then you become qualified to join with somebody else and help them conquer on their soil, and then eventually become some kind of national success where you conquer the enemy to your existence on each soil. Why is that important in this conversation? It's important because your struggle is a created struggle. And because it's a created struggle, it is a solvable created struggle. And when I say your struggle, I'm talking about this. Your financial struggle, your sexual struggle, your marital struggle, your employment struggle, all of those struggles are created struggles. All of those struggles are created. I cannot stress to you, it was designed for you before you ever got here. You have to recreate the strength. And what do I mean by recreate the strength? One thing that I see about our culture, African American men with dreams, visions, but watch this, not the power to bring them to pass. African American women, watch this, with the power to bring anything to pass that they wish to bring to pass, but they don't always have the great dream. One labors unto death, he labors unto death, she labors unto life, but she labors unto life in limitation. So you got an African American man, he gonna work himself to death if he don't go by way of the gun or go by way of the jail. She's going to work herself to life, but she's always gonna be frustrated because she knows that her life can be greater and there was something greater in her to the glory of his seed and bathed the glory of his seed. There's no possible way that the children were supposed to be born and look at both of their parents and say, all y'all crazy. This letter was written in 1712. 300 years plus 1712 equals what? 2012. At the very least, Lynch was successful. He says, my warning is this. The mind has ability to recorrect itself. And they will eventually go through a phenomenon. And that phenomenon will bring them back into a place of productivity. It will reverse the roles. It will bring men back to a place of dynamic of authority and women back to a place of dynamic of authority. And it will correct itself.